Good evening, good evening, good evening. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercies endureth forever. Welcome to our final evening reflection for the year 2020. Our next evening reflection will be published in the year 2021 on January 1. Today we are looking at Day 9, Part 1. Enjoy.
About my purpose point to ponder, God smiles when I trust him. Verse to remember, the Lord is pleased with those who worship him and trust his love. Psalm 147:11, CEV, question to consider, since God knows what is best, in what areas of my life do I need to trust him most? In the heart of worship, give yourselves to God. Surrender your whole being to him to be used for righteous purposes. Romans 6:13, TEV, the heart of worship is surrender. Surrender is an unpopular word, disliked almost as much as the word submission. It implies losing, and no one wants to be a loser. Surrender evokes the unpleasant images of admitting defeat in battle, forfeiting a game, or yielding to a stronger opponent. The word is almost always used in a negative context. Captured criminals surrender to authorities. In today's competitive culture, we are taught to never give up and never give in, so we don't hear much about surrendering. If winning is everything, surrendering is unthinkable. We would rather talk about winning, succeeding, overcoming, and conquering than yielding, submitting, obeying, and surrendering. But surrendering to God is the heart of worship. It is the natural response to God's amazing love and mercy. We give ourselves to him, not out of fear or duty, but in love, because he first loved us. Offering yourself to God is what worship is all about. After spending 11 chapters of the book of Romans explaining God's incredible grace to us, Paul urges us to fully surrender our lives to God in worship. So then, my friends, because of God's great mercy to us, offer yourselves as a living sacrifice to God, dedicated to his service and pleasing to him. This is the true worship that you should offer. True worship bringing God pleasure happens when you give yourself completely to God. Notice the first and last words of that verse are the same. Offer. Offering yourself to God is what worship is all about. This act of personal surrender is called many things: consecration, making Jesus your Lord, taking up your cross, dying to self, yielding to the Spirit. What matters is that you do it, not what you call it. God wants your life, all of it. 95% is not enough. There are three barriers that block our total surrender to God: fear, pride, and confusion. We don't realize how much God loves us. We want to control our own lives. And we misunderstand the meaning of surrender. Can I trust God? Trust is an essential ingredient to surrender. You won't surrender to God unless you trust him. But you can't trust him until you know him better. Fear keeps us from surrendering, but love casts out all fear. The more you realize how much God loves you, the easier surrender becomes. How do you know God loves you? He gives you many evidences. God says he loves you. You're never out of his sight. He cares about every detail of your life. He gave you the capacity to enjoy all kinds of pleasure. He has good plans for your life. He forgives you, and he is lovingly patient with you. God loves you infinitely more than you can imagine. The greatest expression of this is the sacrifice of God's Son for you. God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. If you want to know how much you matter to God, look at Christ with his arms outstretched on the cross, saying, "I love you this much. I'd rather die than live without you." God is not a cruel slave driver or a bully who uses brute force to coerce us into submission. He doesn't try to break our will, but woos us to himself so that we might offer ourselves freely to him. God is a lover and a liberator, and surrendering to him brings freedom, not bondage. When we completely surrender ourselves to Jesus, we discover that he is not a tyrant, but a savior; not a boss, but a brother; not a dictator, but a friend. Admitting our limitations. A second barrier to total surrender is our pride. We don't want to admit that we're just creatures and not in charge of everything. It is the oldest temptation. You'll be like God. That desire to have complete control is the cause of so much stress in our lives. Life is a struggle, but what most people don't realize is that our struggle, like Jacob's, is really a struggle with God. We want to be God, and there's no way we are going to win that struggle. A. W. Tozer said, "The reason why many are still troubled, still seeking, still making little forward progress is because they haven't yet come to the end of themselves. We're still trying to give orders, and interfering with God's work within us. We aren't God and never will be. We are humans. It is when we try to be God that we end up most like Satan, who desired the same thing. We accept our humanity intellectually, but not emotionally. When faced with our own limitations, we react with irritation, anger, and resentment. We want to be taller, or shorter, smarter, stronger, more talented, more beautiful, and wealthier. We want to have it all and do it all, and we become upset when it doesn't happen. Then when we notice that God gave others characteristics we don't have, we respond with envy, jealousy, and self-pity. What it means to surrender. Surrendering to God is not passive resignation, fatalism, or an excuse for laziness. It is not accepting the status quo. It may mean the exact opposite. Sacrificing your life or suffering in order to change what needs to be changed. God often calls surrendered people to do battle on his behalf. Surrendering is not for cowards or doormats. Likewise, it does not mean giving up rational thinking. God would not waste the mind he gave you. God does not want robots to serve him. Surrendering is not repressing your personality. God wants to use your unique personality. Rather than its being diminished, surrendering enhances it. C.S. Lewis observed, "The more we let God take us over, the more truly ourselves we become because he made us. He invented all the different people that you and I were intended to be. It is when I turn to Christ, when I give up myself to his personality, that I first begin to have a real personality of my own." Surrendering is best demonstrated in obedience. You say yes, Lord, to whatever he asks of you. To say no, Lord, is to speak a contradiction. You can't call Jesus your Lord when you refuse to obey him. After a night of failed fishing, Simon modeled surrender when Jesus told him to try again. "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down the nets." Surrendered people obey God's word, even if it doesn't make sense. Another aspect of a fully surrendered life is trust. Abraham followed God's leading without knowing where it would take him. Hannah waited for God's perfect timing without knowing when. Mary expected a miracle without knowing how. Joseph trusted God's purpose without knowing why circumstances happened the way they did. Each of these people were fully surrendered to God. You know you're surrendered to God when you rely on God to work things out instead of trying to manipulate others, force your agenda, and control the situation. You let go and let God work. You don't have to always be in charge. The Bible says, "Surrender yourself to the Lord, and wait patiently for him." Instead of trying harder, you trust more. You also know you're surrendered when you don't react to criticism and rush to defend yourself. Surrendered hearts show up best in relationships. You don't edge others out. You don't demand your rights, and you aren't self-serving when you're surrendered. The most difficult area to surrender for many people is their money. Many have thought, "I want to live for God, but I also want to earn enough money to live comfortably and retire someday." Retirement is not the goal of a surrendered life, because it competes with God for the primary attention of our lives. Jesus said, "You cannot serve both God and money, and wherever your treasure is, your heart will be also." The supreme example of self-surrender is Jesus. The night before his crucifixion, Jesus surrendered himself to God's plan. He prayed, "Father, everything is possible for you. Please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will, not mine."
Thank you, thank you, thank you for joining us for another evening reflection. We trust that the lessons being shared through Pastor Rick Warren's book, The Purpose-Driven Life, will cause us to reflect on our own lives and to see whether or not we are in fact living a purpose-driven life. God bless you. Have a restful night. Bye-bye.